when the kindness and the love of God our Savior toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ our Savior, that having been justified by his grace, we should have become heirs according to the hope of eternal life.
Often use that word, but that singing was awesome. It was great to be able to praise the Lord with all of you. It's great this morning to see a full house. Last week we were a little bit sparse in here, so it's good to see all your faces, and it looks like we've got a lot of Schwartzes in the back here, and welcome to the Schwartz clan that is here. A couple announcements that I need to make is last week I distributed our booklet, our Bible reading booklet for this month, and there's still a whole bunch of copies in the back there. just want to encourage you, if you're someone who struggles with regular devotions or maybe you just haven't done them recently, grab hold of a book. And there's a lot of people in church who are going to be reading through the Gospel of Luke over this next month. And I'd encourage you, jump on board, grab a hold of it, just one chapter a day and a couple questions on each chapter. This will help you be regular in your quiet time. It'll give you something to read and some things to pray about as well. So I'd encourage you, grab one of these as you leave. A couple other things I want to make mention. I think most of you know by now that Mike Norby's mom passed away on Thursday, and we need to continue to be in prayer for Mike and for his family as well. That funeral is going to be Wednesday, and it's going to be in Racine. So we can get you more information if you're interested in driving the 6 hours to go to that, but we will send out an email with some further information on all of this. So one thing we want to do today that we do every year is that we have a special time where we dedicate and we pray for the Awana leaders. Awana starts this Wednesday already, and there's a lot of leaders who are in place and ready to go, and we are excited about this program that we have at our church. It's one of the best ways that we have to reach into our community, make connections with kids and with adults as well, and just opportunities to share the gospel. And so one of the things I'd like to do right now is have everyone who is involved in Awana for this next year, if you could stand up, and I'd like you to all come forward too. And I think probably some of you say, well, I don't want to walk all the way to the front. It doesn't matter. Come forward anyway. We want to see you so we can have a chance to pray for you for this next year. Just a great blessing to have so many people who serve the Lord willingly on our Wednesday nights. And I'd like to ask the rest of you, take note of each person who is up here. Take note and maybe target someone that would be the person that you can be in prayer for. Every Wednesday night as kids fill up this building, our leaders need prayer, and also as God's word goes out every single week, the word goes out, and we need to be praying that word would fall on the fertile soil of hearts that have been prepared by the Holy Spirit. So I'd just like to have a word of prayer and have all of you just pray with me as we pray for this group and also for this program over this next year. God, our Father, right now I come before you, and I'm so grateful for the many volunteers that we have who come out every Wednesday night to serve you. God, we're grateful for all the kids that you bring as well. And God, we know that you have plans and purposes. You have plans and purposes that you would have each one of these leaders continue to grow in their relationship with you, and that's done so often just as they serve, they learn, and they grow. And so, God, I pray for these leaders that they would be strengthened, that you would give them wisdom, that you would draw them ever closer to you. And then, God, I also think about all the kids from our church and also the kids from our community who will be coming out. God, I just pray that you would prepare their hearts, that you would grab hold of some of them and just allow them to fully understand the gospel message, that it can change their lives, not just for their time on earth, but for all eternity. And so, God, I just pray for these things, and I ask your blessing upon the program. And, God, we pray for all these leaders as well. And we do this all in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. You guys can be seated.
I once was lost, but now
There are certain stories that are found in the scripture that are both fun and somewhat funny, as well as being very instructive for each of us. The story that we're going to read this morning about the Apostle Peter is found in the book of Acts, and it features a tyrant king, an unjust arrest. It features answers to prayers and a very fitting ending. And the story that we're going to read this morning and talk about, we are going to get a picture or a vision of God's word at work in the world. And one of the things we're going to learn this morning is that there is absolutely nothing that can halt the spread of the gospel message. The story that we're going to read provides us with a great picture of Peter as we slowly but surely begin to work our way to the study of 1 Peter. This morning, and I already hear pages turning in your Bibles, which I love it that you bring Bibles and that you're turning. But before you turn to the book of Acts chapter 12, we'll get there in just a minute. Before you do that, I would ask that you turn to the book of 1 Peter. I'm going to read just one verse out of the book of 1 Peter because it very beautifully sets up an outline for everything that we're going to read in Acts chapter 12. So if you have a Bible, please turn first to the book of 1 Peter, and we'll read that, and then we'll shift gears back to the book of Acts. Now, I know it's going to take you a little while longer to find 1 Peter. It's almost right to the end. But the verse that I'm going to have you look up is 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 12. Again, it's a great picture of what God is at work doing. You know, sometimes we read the scriptures and we can read through the book of Acts, and we know that God is at work, and we know that God hears things, and we know that God plans things. But what we see here is Peter writing much later, perhaps had the recollection of what had taken place in Acts chapter 12. So 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 12. Here's what he says about the Lord. And by the way, this is a quote from back in Psalm chapter 34, which David wrote. But he says this, Peter says this, 1 Peter 3, 12. He says, "For the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers, but the face of the Lord is against those who do evil." The eyes of the Lord are always on the righteous, and God's ears are always open to the prayers of his people, and the face of the Lord is set against all those who do evil or all those who oppose him. We'll deal more with that in just a minute. I'd like you to turn back now with me to the book of Acts chapter 12. Acts chapter 12, and I'm going to read the first 24 verses. There's 25 verses here. I'm going to read the first 24. If you've got a Bible, please follow along with me as I read. If you didn't bring a Bible, there's some in the pews or the chairs right in front of you. Again, Acts chapter 12, the verse that we just read in 1 Peter chapter 3 really outlines everything that we're going to be looking at right here. So pay attention as I read through, and you will take note of certain things that will emerge. So Acts chapter 12, starting in verse 1. It says, "Now about that time, Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some from the church." By the way, this is the book of Acts records all sorts of great things that God is doing, and it also records all the opposition that begins to fall upon Christians and upon the church. And so Herod right here in this verse, and we'll talk about this in a minute, He's an arm of Satan sent to oppose God's work in the church.
So about that time, Herod the king stretched out his hand to harass some from the church. And then he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. James and John, of course, are part of the apostles. They're part of the 12 who were with Jesus doing everything. And here James dies, verse 2. Then we get to verse 3. And because he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to seize Peter also. Now it was during the days of unleavened bread. And so when he had arrested him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four squads of soldiers to keep him, intending to bring him before the people after the Passover. By the way, I think probably most of you are better at math than I am, but to my count, 16 soldiers to guard this one guy. I think Herod might have been a little skittish here. 16 guys to watch one Peter right here. Verse 5, Peter was therefore kept in the prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. And when Herod was about to bring him out, that night Peter was sleeping, bound with two chains between two soldiers, and the guards before the door were keeping the prison. And now behold, an angel of the Lord stood by him, and a light shone in the prison. And he struck Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, "Arise quickly." And his chains fell off of his hands. And the angel said to him, "Gird yourself and tie on your sandals." And so he did. And then he said to him, "Put on your garment and follow me." So he went out and followed him and did not know what was done by the angel was real, but he thought he was seeing a vision. And when they were past the first and the second guard posts, they came to the iron gate that leads to the city, which opened to them of its own accord. And they went out and went down one street, and immediately the angel departed from him. Now, verse 11. And when Peter had come to himself, he said, "Now I know for certain that the Lord has sent his angel and has delivered me from the hand of Herod and from the expectation of the Jewish people." And so when he had considered this, he came to the house of Mary, the mother of John, whose surname was Mark, where many had gathered together who were praying. And as Peter knocked on the door of the gate, a girl named Rhoda came to answer. When she recognized Peter's voice, because of her gladness, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter stood before the gate. But then they said to her, "You are beside yourself." And yet she kept insisting that it was so. And so they said, "It is his angel." And now Peter continued knocking. And when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. But motioning to them with his hand to keep silent, he declared to them how the Lord had brought him out of the prison. And he said, "Go tell these things to James and to the brethren." And he departed and went to another place. Then as soon as it was day, there was no small stir among the soldiers about what had become of Peter. But when Herod had searched for him and not found him, he examined the guards and commanded that they should all be put to death. And he went down from Judea to Caesarea and stayed there. Now Herod, verse 20, we kind of shift gears a little bit, still talking about Herod. Now Herod had been very angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon, but they came to him with one accord, and having made Blastus, the king's personal aide, their friend, they asked for peace because their country was supplied with food from the king's country. So on a set day, Herod, arrayed in royal apparel, sat on his throne, and he gave an oration to them. And the people kept shouting, "The voice of a god and not a man." Then immediately, an angel of the Lord struck him because he did not give glory to God and he was eaten by worms and died. But the word of God grew and multiplied. Sort of poetic justice right here at the end. Very sudden, struck by worms, died, that's it. But in the midst of all of this, the word of God grew and was multiplied. So we've got God at work in the world, and even despite this evil tyrant, God's word is at work. Just some quick background here in the book of Acts before I start breaking down the passage that we're going to look at here. A couple things that are going on. First of all, we see in the book of Acts, and this is not on your outline, so don't look, but if you want to jot down notes, you're welcome to do so. But we need to understand this. Of course, Jesus dies at the end of the Gospels, and then he rose again, and then he ascended into heaven, and the Holy Spirit came down, and the gospel is on the move. These 11 apostles who are left, and then they added another one, and these guys are off sharing the gospel, and the church is growing, and it's multiplying, and the Holy Spirit is working through different men and women, so the gospel continues to go out. And as you read the book of Acts countless times, it uses the word multiplied. It wasn't just that people were added to the number of disciples, but it was multiplied. This means that people were telling more than one other person, and the word just went out, and God was glorified, God was magnified, people were coming to Christ, the gospel going out, the Holy Spirit at work. It is an exciting time in the church. And then, as I said earlier, anytime that we see God at work, and I think probably a lot of you know this already, anytime we see God at work, we also know that Satan is going to be at work also. Satan wants to derail and shut down anything that God has got going on. And so I'll tell you this, as we hit this stage in the book of Acts, Satan is ramping up the persecution of the Christians. And we see this right away in verse 1 and then 2. Herod stretched out his hand to begin attacking the Christians and attacking the church. So let's look at the full flow of the story, because this is where we are right here. The flow of the story is this. Herod is causing trouble for the Christians. Make no mistake, Herod is one evil guy. Now, this Herod would be the grandson of the Herod that had all the babies executed when Jesus was first born. So this would be, that would be this Herod's grandfather. This Herod would also be the nephew of the Herod in the Gospels who had John the Baptist beheaded. This guy, it's just a whole line, a whole bloodline of bad, evil, corrupt men. What we see in this guy here, he was not an elected official. He was appointed by Rome, and he's appointed to keep the peace in Jerusalem. Herod right here, classic politician. When he was in Rome, he lived and did what the Romans did. When he was in Jerusalem, he tried to appease the people like politicians do. And so he would always try to curry favor with these guys. And he saw already that the Jewish people hated the Christians. And so to boost his own, the opinion of the people about him, to boost his ratings essentially, what he did is he arrests James. And not much is said here, but here we have James. James was one of the inner circle. He was one of the three guys that Jesus spent the most time with, and really not much of a mention except in verse 2, he killed James, the brother of John, with the sword. And that's it. That's it for James. We don't read about him anymore in the New Testament. This James is dead and gone because of this evil, corrupt tyrant named Herod. Now, Herod, of course, we read, sees that this pleased the Jewish people. They were excited. Hey, this guy, this Christian out here, has been preaching this anti-Jewish stuff. Thank goodness he is dead. And so the people, the Jewish people, loved it that James had been killed. And so Herod sees that and he says, okay, I'm gonna do one better. Now I'm gonna get the next guy, Peter. Peter was like the right-hand man of Jesus in their minds. And so Herod goes and he arrests Peter. And the whole plan is to repeat the process and kill Peter as well. I'll tell you this. The story is fascinating to me because it sort of mingles together the wickedness of an evil tyrant also with the sovereignty of God. And it brings the question maybe to your mind, why did God see fit to spare Peter? I mean, we read about this miraculous escape from prison. Why did God spare Peter but not spare James? And I have to tell you this, that we don't have a clear answer for that. We don't know. God does things and we don't always understand. But we know that God is in control. We know that God is sovereign. And God, for some reason, allowed Herod the tyrant to do some certain things, to operate sort of on a leash. Now, could God have rescued James? Of course he could. God is still in control, and God is always in control. But for some reason, God saw fit to rescue Peter in this chapter, but God saw fit to take James home with him. We don't know why, so I can't answer that for you. So second of all, first we see Herod is causing trouble, but second, and this is the best news here, and I believe we can learn so many lessons from this, what are the people doing? What are the people doing? Peter gets arrested. Everybody knows what happened to James. James is dead, and the people no doubt had prayed for him, and they were no doubt mourning and grieving and everything else, and then Peter gets arrested. And Peter was kind of an unofficial leader in the church. And so what do the people do? Do they storm the prison and try to break him out? Are they baking cakes with saws in there? What are they doing? They go to the house of this woman, the mother of John Mark, and they start praying together. The people are praying for Peter while he is in prison. I mean, just look at verse 5 with me. Get your eyes back onto the page of Scripture. Because there is the way this is written is great. Peter was therefore kept in prison, but constant prayer was offered to God for him by the church. So here's the way I look at it. Peter is locked up, but the prayers of the saints are never locked up. Peter might be bound and chained, but the prayers that were going up to God are wide open, and God hears all of those prayers. The people are praying. I'll tell you this, as we look at this, we discover that it's the very next day that Peter is to be executed. Like the very next morning, they were going to haul him out and execute him in front of all the people. And I don't know how long Peter was in jail. We don't know how long he was chained to these guards. We get the impression it was more than just overnight. It was a long time. And there he is in jail or in prison. And the people had been praying and praying and praying. And there was no answer. And there was no answer. And there was no answer until now. The night before he was about to be killed, God decides to deliver. Well, God decided long ago, but God waited until then to free Peter. Now, did you ever ask yourself as you read through, now, why does God do the things he does? And we don't know, but as I look at this, why did God wait so long? Why did God take all of this time before he rescued Peter? And I think the obvious answer is that sometimes God waits to the last minute or the 11th hour or whatever phrase you want to use. Sometimes God waits right until the end for the sole purpose of motivating his people to pray and to pray fervently and to pray passionately. And so we have these people and they are praying fervently. Constant prayer is going up. Now I think that for you in your lives, and perhaps for me as well, we don't pray like we ought. And I feel this is kind of a reoccurring theme that comes up in the Scriptures. We don't pray like we should, and sometimes We need that swift kick in the pants to get us praying more. I think for these people here, these early disciples and the apostles, they probably needed this time to get the, just to drive them to that point of going before the Lord. And so I'd ask you this, what are the things or when maybe one of the times in your life that you've been most motivated to pray? And I'd be willing to bet that it's those times that are the hardest or the darkest or most fraught with fear and apprehension. Those are the times that you are so close to God because you are so motivated to pray, because you are beyond yourself and you can't get out of it on your own. And so you go to your knees in prayer and you cry out to God. And it's not just a one time and then that's it. You are constantly in prayer because you know that there is only one who can answer your need. There's only one who can rescue you, and that is the Lord. And I guess I would challenge you with this. I do believe that each and every one of us needs to be more constant and more fervent in our prayer life. So often we are just haphazard about our prayers and we'll toss off a quick prayer and quick prayers are fine, but then we need to keep on revisiting these prayers again and again and again throughout our days. Take the time to be praying. We need to be praying people. Why do we suppose that these people were praying so fervently for Peter? Well, certainly because he was about to die the next day. But I think the deeper meaning in this is they were praying so fervently because they cared. And I want to dwell on this just for a second here. These people prayed passionately, constantly, fervently because they really, truly cared about Peter. I want to challenge you with that. The simple truth is this. You will pray if you care about something, or switch that around even. If you care, you will pray. This is just a fact of life. If you truly, really, desperately, deeply care about something, you will be praying about it. If you really care about lost people who are dying and going to hell, then you will be praying that the gospel message would reach them and that they will turn their lives over to Christ. If you really care about missions and missionaries, then you will pray for them. If you really care about persecuted people or about other people in the church or about the spread of the gospel, then you will pray. We pray about those things that we care about, that we are concerned about in our lives. And God knows what we need, right? We all know that. God knows what we need even before we ever pray it. So why do we pray this? And I've said this before too. We pray it because it unburdens us. It's like walking around with a backpack full of rocks that's so heavy and we're so weighed down and we just need to take this off. And it's taking our burdens off. That's what we do when we pray. All the burdens of the earthly life, all the struggles and strife and all the things that are just weighing us down, we take that before the Lord and we unburden ourselves, and He wants to take those burdens from us. And so that's what this prayer is all about. Third point in our flow of the story is we have got this angelic vision and release, the angelic escape. Here is what happens, and we've all read this. But again, we've got a great story right here of this tremendous prison break, but it's without all the planning and without all the secret maps and without digging a tunnel or using a little hammer to break through. This is just a snap of the fingers, and God sends His angel to do this work. Get note of this. God can easily deliver His servants from anything. From anything that comes against them, God can easily deliver His servants. There is no prison that can shut God out or keep people in if God wills to freeze them. This was no big deal for God to get Peter out of this most secure prison that Herod could ever devise. No big deal for God. 16 guys guarding this one man. Here is Peter in the cell. He's got a chain on each wrist, and there's guards on both sides. Okay, everybody knows you're never going to escape from that. And besides that, you're locked up in a cell. And besides that, there's one guard tower and then another guard tower and then a gate. There is no human possible way that Peter could ever escape this. And why did Herod have him guarded by so many people? Because earlier in the book of Acts, Peter has already been arrested two different times. One time, through God's wisdom, God allowed Peter to kind of talk his way out. God freed him that way. Another time, it was this miraculous escape, kind of like this. Peter and John and some of the other guys were arrested, and God kind of snapped his fingers, and boom, out went Peter and John and the other guys, and they went to the temple and started preaching again. So there's no prison that can keep God out. And if God wants to do something, God can do it. So God sent his angel. It was probably pitch black, and suddenly the light was illuminating the cell, and then the chains just fell right off, and the angel had to knock Peter a little bit and say, "Get moving, Peter, we got to go. Put on your sandals and get your cloak on, and we're getting out of here." And Peter just followed him out. Peter thought he was kind of in a daze, didn't really know exactly what's going on. And they get to this gate that was all locked up, and it's like just opens wide, and out goes Peter. And then it says he kind of came to himself and like, "Whoa, here I am out of the prison already." And so this miraculous escape right here. And here is Peter. Peter sleeping like a baby through all this. Peter was supposed to be executed the very next day, and here he is able to sleep. Now, I'll say this. This probably would have been tough on Peter. I would imagine, anyway, if we were in Peter's shoes here, that he's been out preaching the gospel and things have been going well, but suddenly, imagine we're in a church and someone from our church gets arrested and then taken off somewhere and executed because they were proclaiming the gospel. And then after that, then the officials say, "Now we're going to get somebody else and execute them." I mean, it would have been pretty frightening for whoever that second person would be. But Peter trusted. Peter had faith in the Lord. God had already rescued him before, and God could do so again. Peter probably also a little bit grieving because his friend, his colleague, had just been killed. But Peter was confident in the Lord. And I think there's a couple things that stand out to me about this. First of all, I think Peter is strong because of all those prayers that have been going up. We've talked before in Philippians chapter 4 refers to a peace. There's a peace that passes or transcends all understanding. Sometimes God gives us peace in our lives in the midst of a storm. It can be all these terrible things that seem to be befalling us, but for some reason, we have confidence and we have peace. We know we can take a step back mentally and say, "You know what? I know that God is in control. He's in control despite the whole mess that is raging around." And I believe that is the answer to prayer. God will grant a peace that passes or transcends all understanding. It makes no human sense at all how we can be calm in certain situations. But we don't need human sense. We've got God sense right there. But then also I think in Peter recognized the absolute and ultimate sovereignty of God over everything in the world. Peter knew that Herod was just a puppet. Peter knew that Herod, the tyrant, the king, whatever, was ultimately had to be in submission to whatever God's will. And then Peter probably recognized, and we're going to learn this once we hit the book of 1 Peter, tremendous book, but Peter didn't have hope for this life only. Peter's hope was based not on the temporary 60, 80, 90, 100 and some years on this earth. Peter's hope was a living hope for the future. For all of eternity, Peter had this hope in God. And so that's why Peter was able to sleep like a baby, because he fully trusted in God. Whatever happened, God still was the one who was in control. God is still the one on the throne. Point number four in our story, can work through a couple of these faster. Revelation to the disciples. How crazy is this story? Here, these disciples, again, picture this. These disciples fervently praying, "Dear Lord, please send Peter free. Let him go." And then suddenly Peter gets set free, and Peter is on his way, and he goes and stops by the house where they're all praying. And they won't even let him through the door. Again, look at the kind of the play on words that we have in this passage. Here, God opened the doors of this prison so Peter is able to just stroll right out of there. But the one thing he can't do is get into the home of the people who were praying for him. Mary's house, locked up, prison wide open. So there's Peter knocking on the gate. The servant girl comes, and she believes, she sees him, she believes. She's all so excited that she doesn't even unlock the gate. She just runs back and tells everybody else. And then everybody else is sitting there like, "Hey, quit interrupting us, okay? We're praying for Peter. Rhoda, stop talking. We're praying." It's like what I say to my kids when they're yakking. "We're praying. Stop talking, okay?" But here she says, "No, it's Peter. Peter is really out there." And these people, these disciples who have been praying, are filled with unbelief. It's fascinating to me, but yet I kind of like this story because it shows that these people are kind of like us sometimes. How often do we pray in unbelief? We might be praying for something, but then thinking that, it'll never really happen. Yeah, it'll never really happen. "Dear God, please do this, that, and the other thing, but I understand, God, it's probably never going to happen." And so with these disciples, they kind of had a wake-up call because God is saying, "You know what? I can do these things. I can do miracles. You just watch and see what happens." And so ultimately, this revelation to the disciples, they see, they understand, they get excited then too. Their faith is bolstered because they see answered prayer. Then we see the next point is Herod's anger. Herod is angry. Here he had these 16 guys to watch this one guy. They had the prison, they had chains, they had guard towers, they had everything. They couldn't contain him at all. Everything about it, probably to Herod in his pagan state, probably looked like an inside job. Like it probably looked like these guys just let him go, or he paid him off or something. But Herod is angry, and so then he has all these guards killed. Here's the problem. The problem is Herod set himself up to oppose God. Right from verse 1 of chapter 12 all the way until his death. In verse 23, Herod stood up to oppose God. Herod said, "I'm the guy on the throne. I'm the one who's calling the shots here." And God stood back and said, "No, you're not." And so Herod is angry. He's angry at these soldiers. He has them all killed. And then we get to kind of the wrap up, the poetic justice. And it's this, and it's our sixth point. God will not tolerate opposition for very long. God will not tolerate opposition for very long at all. God doesn't tolerate those who oppose him. Here Herod is shaking his fist and saying, "I'm in control of this situation." God says, "You are not." And so ultimately, Herod dies. By the way, I did some reading on this, and this is a fascinating wrap-up to this story, too. One of the historians at that time, a man named Josephus, was writing about this account, and he says Herod was dressed all in silver and was given this fine speech, and then all these people who were kind of kissing up to Herod so he would give them more food, these people are the ones who are shouting, "Oh, it's the voice of a god and not a man." And Scripture says, because he did not give any glory to God. God struck him with worms, and he died. So I did some reading on these worms. These, you know, we always think, well, tapeworms, but anyway, it's a gross deal. I'm not even going to tell you all of it, except somehow he ingests these worms, and it forms like cysts in his belly, and then these cysts like break open, and these worms crawl out and eat him from the inside out. It's gross. It's terrible. There's probably YouTube videos. Don't watch it at church. Start to finish. Start to finish. The lesson that we learn from Herod is this. To seek glory for ourselves is to declare war on God. Okay? To seek glory for ourselves is to stand opposed to God. A couple of things I just want to make very quick observations right here. God does not love us any less when he allows tragedy into our lives. Okay, we look at this story. We see that James died. James was killed with the sword by Herod, but Peter wasn't. Now, does that mean, well, clearly, God loved Peter more than he loved James? Not at all. God loves his children all the same. And God did not love James any less, and that's not why James died by the sword, but Peter lived. That's not it at all. In fact, to look at it the other way, we might look at it and say, you know what? God loved James so much that God took him to be with him. We have got just a terrible misunderstanding about life and death and eternity in our world. Thad and I were talking about that a little bit before I came in this morning. We've got such a huge misunderstanding. We think that this time on earth is the most important time and that this is so significant, and we fail to account for all of eternity. And that's my second observation, is that we need to view death from God's perspective, not from our own earthly perspective. Look at death from the eternal, not from the temporary. Psalms 116, verse 15, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Okay, we think precious in the sight of the Lord is a life well lived, or when we sing great praises. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. God takes his people to be home with him, and he doesn't do it as a punishment. He does it to bless them ultimately. Certainly, it's sad for us here on earth, but God does this to bless that person. I'll tell you this. As soon as John passed over into glory, he realized how temporary and short life on this earth was. I say John, James, when James went. Last observation very quickly. I want to remind you that no matter what happens here on earth, it's the throne of heaven that is still in control. More importantly, it's the one who sits on the throne in heaven who is ultimately in control. The nations rage. There's issues with countries and presidents and senators and politics and people and wars and rumors of wars. And yeah, there are issues here on earth, and there are different thrones set up here on earth, but there is one throne that is above all, and it is our sovereign God who sits on that throne. Conclusions, where do we go from here? Beware of pride, number one. Be very careful. Even most of you are going to say, well, I would never do what Herod did. Okay, that's fine. But where is the pride in your life? What is it that tries to set you apart from other people in sort of an arrogant way? What is it? Be very, very careful so you do not fall into... We live our lives with two opportunities. It can be either God exalting or self-exalting. We've all got a choice. What are we going to do? You're going to live your life to exalt yourself, or you're going to try to live your life to exalt God? I think you know what is right. Second point, be fervent in your prayers. Not just constant, but fervent. Fervent gives the impression or carries with it the idea is that you are straining hard. It's an athletic word that's used. Straining hard, praying regularly, doing the dirty work of prayer to get it done. It's not always going to be easy, but we get diligent about our prayers. Number three, never doubt the power of God. We see that significant error in these disciples who were praying. We pray about something, recognize that God can always answer. So never doubt his power. Number four, God's word will grow and flow. There is nothing, no evil tyrant, nothing that is on this earth that can ever halt the spread of the gospel. God is in control. God is in charge. His gospel goes out. That's why I love verse 24. In the midst of all of this crazy king and everything else, the persecution that's coming, the word of God grew and multiplied. Final point is this. God is the deliverer of his children. God will deliver his people. It might not always be like we want or that we expect, but God delivers. God delivered Peter out of that prison. And I'll say this too. God delivered James too. Yes, James died on this earth, but God took him and delivered him up to heaven. And God probably looked at him and said, well done, good and faithful servant. That's delivery. It's a different way than we think. But I'll tell you this. If you had a choice of being in heaven with the Father in all the glory forever and ever and ever, why would you want to be Peter and stay on earth? James had it better. He got to go to be in the presence of the Father right then and right there. It's also not an accident that this whole story takes place right during the days of unleavened bread or the feast of unleavened bread. What this is telling us is this is during the Passover. I just want to make a very quick connection for you right here. Remember the Passover from the Old Testament? Back in the book of Exodus, God reached down and delivered his people, sent Moses, and the people had to offer the lamb, and it's the beautiful picture of Christ and everything else. But it was during the Passover that God delivered his people. Now look where we're at in the book of Acts chapter 12. It's Passover, and once again, God is delivering his people. God delivered Peter in the midst of everything else. I love this story because there's so much symbolism taking place, and it's a beautiful picture of our God who loves each and every one of us so desperately and so much that he sent his son Jesus to come and rescue us. God loves us. God cares for us. God wants us to be in prayer to him, and God wants our lives too. My challenge for you this morning is be willing to believe and be willing to trust and be willing to pray and be willing to understand that great sovereignty that our God has over this earth. Let me pray with you this morning. God, I'm grateful once again that you brought each person here today. God, I pray that as we come before you today, we'd be willing to make these decisions to follow after you. Father, even as we looked at the passage in 1 Peter, and we see that you are the one who sees what's going on in our lives. And God, we know that you are the one who hears all of our prayers. And God, that you stand opposed to all those who do evil. God, I just pray that each one of us would be praying people, that we would be people who seek you out daily. God, I pray that we'd be people who trust in you. And God, I pray that we'd be people who live our lives for the spread of the gospel message. Once again, I'm grateful for each person that you've brought here this morning. And we do pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.